am not a Plone core developer, and I'm pretty well known as the Plone loudmouth. That's why I'm here. So fasten your seatbelts. Why I'm giving this talk? I'm doing Plone development since 12 years now, and basically 10 years as professional consultant for Python and SOAP stuff. And at least over the last year in 2014, we've seen a growing developer pain, as a pain myself. I worked with some developers in the community and on the customer side on several projects, and I thought it was time to give a talk about my past experience and then just saying what we had as experience and so on. We've seen some rising and unpredictable project costs over the last years in Plone projects, and especially this year we had lots of frustration at pretty every corner. So this year I was basically working on four bigger Plone projects. Almost everything was legacy stuff. And let's give a rough overview of the stuff. Then you know what we have been working on. We had one customer side for a pretty small side. We did migration from 4.2 to 4.3, some third-party custom code. We always had migration issues with tiny MCA, where times aim wasn't longer working. We had issues, problems with JavaScript, especially when there was a jQuery UI in the game. We had a bit. We took over a project by the beginning of the year from a company that didn't know about Plone and produced a huge website with about 40 different portal types and so on. We did some migration from 4.0 to 4.2. Lots of third-party garbage code that we could throw away. We tried the migration. We got the migration to 4.1 to 4.2 running in a pretty fast, but then we tried to go to 4.3 and run into some trouble, so we're currently on 4.2. And we couldn't even get an estimate to the customer what a migration from 4.2 to 4.3 would cost. So basically, usually my migration would say, okay, you pay what it costs, but if you are in business and customers would expect fixed price estimates, so it's pretty hard to give an estimate here. Another project we implemented 3 years ago was for German Institute in Freiburg in Germany. We migrated to 4.2. We also had here some problems, like suddenly image references containing the full URL or stuff like that, or mixed UIDs, paths, and so on. So kind of a mess. And the biggest project I'm currently working on is a relaunch of eteaching.org. It's a pretty huge eteaching platform for an institute in my hometown, Tübingen, near Stuttgart. And we're doing a full migration from Plone 2.0, 1, 5, Plone 3, a mixture of all and everything, to Plone 4.3 with dexterity. We have been trying to use Plone app event, Plone app widgets in the build out and so on, and we had lots of fun, and most of my tweets over the last several months basically came from this project. And especially in this project, I was basically a trainer. I didn't do much of the implementation. I built a skeleton and so on, did the training, and was always approached by the internal developer for, there's a problem, please look at it. And I looked at it and said, So that's where we are. Another project I'm running since 2010 is Oncopedia, a German medical site where we had several migrations from 4.0 to 4.3 in several steps. And in every step we had lots of pain, strange problems, and so on. And the complete code base basically is more code with workaround code than basically code doing the actual functionality. I'm not talking about user experience, because lots of stuff is going on in Plone 5, and that's on my topic because I'm backend developer and I don't care much about user experience. I care about user experience. Yeah. Chrome running. I care about user experience, but we have people like Stefan Tobuki, which is doing all the UI front end for our project. So we have a separation between back end and front end. So I'm basically talking about some back end developer pain. This is just a rough collection. It's not complete, and but one problem or one key problem I identified over the last month is one issue with dexterity. Dexterity started several years ago with the idea of making development of content types in Plone much more easier, much more Pythonic. So in an ideal world, you would basically use Plone API to create a new content type, and then the idea would basically being Pythonic means you have the object and then could use the attribute access or a setting of attributes for modifying the content of the object. This is okay as long as you have only one schema, but with behaviors, things are a bit more complicated. So in this case, we have a my type, and it has its schema with attribute 1, and you can either by configuration or by just clicking around add new behaviors, introducing other attributes. So if you are setting or reading values from such an object instance, we've seen lots of code where basically all objects still using attribute access. But the official way, the right way, is basically you have to adapt the object to its interface and then perform the modification or the read rate on the adapted object. And this is no longer a Pythonic way to do it right. Especially for me as an integrator, or for me with 10 years experience back in development, I know about the subcomponent architecture, but some developer in a company, it's very hard to train them to all this content, and then so basically this implementation pattern is kind of a bit of a problem. And some extra strange thing that happened, especially with Plone event, I think there was something when you set the start and end date on the event instance, you had to call some subscriber to perform some internal modifications of the time zone and so on. So question is this Pythonic? Raise your hand if you think this approach is okay. Okay. Another pain comes, in my opinion, that we have lots of code where we don't do enough parameter checks, sufficient error handling, and giving the developer reasonable error messages. So my personal enemy is set receive form. I started with set receive form actually only some months ago. I always made the way around this framework for several reasons, but in this project I couldn't get around. Some problems with set reform are basically it doesn't perform much checks between schema, field definitions, widgets, and so on. You can basically just enrich it to some field, and if it doesn't match for some reason, you get some non-speaking error message. And this happens all the time. This is especially a problem when you have large forms. We had in one case a form with 30 or 35 fields, and then you just write code, and then there's one problem, you get an error message, and then the error message doesn't tell you about which field or where the exact problem is. So that's basically a pain in the end. You just end up using a PDB, going into some module where the error occurs, and then going up and down in the stack trace, and then just trying to figure out the same. It's also the same with vocabulary set. One form with 20 select fields, 20 vocabularies, and then I think there was one set receive form version where we got this no value set field, where I didn't get an answer from the stack trace, where actually in which vocabulary the error occurred. So for the developer, that's pretty painful, and you just write code, and you need two or three times the time for debugging the code or finding the root problem. And there is some other madness in the form world. For set reform, we have basically the core module. There's something in addition like Plone set reform and Plone app set reform, kind of wrappers or better integration of the original module into Plone. The same with formlib and fiveformlib. And this results also in some strange code when you write a form and import from three or four different modules, this, and as a developer, you don't know how this fits together. Another problem is the complexity of Plone, especially the growing complexity of Plone. When you look at Plone from the outside, it looks like a nice iceberg. Thank you. So basically, for example, in our project, the internal developer had an expectation. He said, okay, his old Plone 2 system was old and crappy and maintained to that after several years. And he was expecting from Plone 4.3, yeah, some nice framework and so on. But when you look under the hood, you just see the rest of Plone. So basically, a Plone core installation is around consists of 250 modules, but we've also seen that customer installations with a large amount of add-ons have up to 400 modules. So the question is, who could understand this completely? It's a big problem. It was already a problem when I was sub-release manager. We had only had perhaps not that much modules, but giving an overview of the modules and all how the stuff fits together, that's a big problem. So this complexity is getting a problem for us. I was thinking a lot about the role of the subcomponent architecture in the SOAP world and the Plone world. Is it good? Is it bad? Who considers a Plone as a CCA as a good thing for Plone? Raise your hand.
Compare with alternatives too.
Sure. Who thinks that CCA is not as good as it would be? Okay. So for me, this the subcomponent architecture is a framework. It's an implementation framework, and it's not an API. Over the last one started SOAP, when started Plone using the CA, was Plone 2.5 or 3? I can't recall, but 3. So the CEA is a core, it's basically the foundation of the Plone core right now, because all new modules since 3.0 are basically built on interface adapters, multi-adapters, and so on. And as that, the CEA has lots of good parts, but also many bad parts. The brain fuck feature of the subcomponent actors are basically multi-adapters. Because they don't lead to better code and they're hard to read. And especially to developers that are not familiar with the thinking of adapters and so on, they don't get it. But the CCA is basically a reasonable implementation framework, but the code can be complex and pretty complicated. But in many parts of Plone, the CCA is fully exposed to the developer, and it's, in my opinion, partly misused as an API.
Yeah, I just want to say exactly this. Pyramid is using CCA internally, and yeah, I've been using Pyramid for over a year and a half now, and you don't see it in Pyramid.
Exactly.
It's hidden away.
Exactly.
It has nice APIs over CCA, and that works beautifully. The problem with Plone is exactly that. You have to deal with CCA in your day-to-day.
Exactly. I couldn't say that better. So basically, from my point of view, I don't want to see any interfaces, adapters, stuff that belong to a particular framework, let's say the portal machinery or so. I don't want to see this stuff on the developer level. I want a clear API. Perhaps I must be able to define a schema, for example, for forms. That's fine. But stuff like multi-adapters, dealing with that stuff in my own code, that's a no-go. I don't like that. And this comes basically to the next point, lack of explicit and documented APIs. So what are APIs? APIs define entry point to a particular functionality. I have a module, I have a portlet. I want to be able to add portlets, I want to configure them, and so on. And APIs should basically encapsulate functionality and hide complexity from the developer. They also define a well-defined behavior. Basically, the public API can be documented, it can be tested, and so on. And as a side effect of that, I know my clear entry points of the API. I can perform validation of incoming data, I can perform validation of outgoing data, I can enforce constraints. So as it happens with Plone API, it's basically a facade from the design pattern point of view. You have some methods, and you can just hide the complexity as in Plone API behind some methods. For example, Plone API can't create encapsulates this invoke factory call and so on. You could perform additional checks, you could perform, you could introduce your own error handling. For example, not all exceptions that are coming from Plone should be given back to the user. You could basically just say you introduce an exception, object exists, like stuff like that, instead of perhaps performing some kind of key or attribute error, which is non-speaking. So in general, APIs should be humane. And there is some very nice and important talk from Kenneth Wright. He's the author of the Python request module. And he gave a talk, I think, last year at the PyCon conference about Python for humans. And if you have time, please look at it. It's pretty impressive and explains a bit more what I'm thinking about that. Migration pain. As I said, we had 4 or 5 migrations this year, and typical error patterns are that tiny MCA never worked after migration. Never, ever. we always had issues. They could be sometimes solved easily, but in, let's say, 2 or 3 cases, I just couldn't solve it and installed a collective CK editor. Then Plone worked again. Then problems with JavaScript, as I said, we had problems with jQuery UI stuff, and this could be easily solved, but in some cases it was pretty hard to find the right combination of, especially when we are using, have been using Plone for 3 together with Plone app event, Plone app widgets, and Plone app content types. It was very hard to find the right versions that went to, well together without bringing each other. So we are now having a version in this project which is pretty old, that works, but I was trying to update to the latest version, to the latest officially documented versions, especially with Plone event, and it's made poof, and nothing worked again. So that's a bit frustrating, especially for the developers in the companies. The problems with failing migration is basically, as I said, they take time, they take more time. We have costs, we have rising costs. And in some projects, we cannot tell the customer that, okay, you have a site, this migration will cost you, let's say, 5 days, 10 days, because we have this huge swamp and nobody knows what's happening. And the real cost can only be estimated actually when you have done the migration. So that's a big problem from the ingress point of view when we are working with customers.
Why would you always upgrade?
You don't have to do always upgrades, but for example, when you have a Plone 4 site, I guess that Plone 4.3 will be the latest official Plone version.
Yeah.
before 5, and at some point your customers should upgrade to perhaps the latest Plone version in order to get either the latest bug fixes for 3, or security updates are usually working with older version as well. It depends on. We have some sites running on 4.0 still, but in some cases we just want to upgrade, and because we want to add new features, and I don't want to work always with old Plone 4.0.0 versions, or because these versions have lots of bugs. Some of them are fixed in 4.1 and 4.2. So in some cases, you just want to upgrade in order to have some more stable versions. But it just depends on every project, and I don't recommend upgrading with every for every customer. Well, you know all the problems with legacy. Sometimes Plone feels a bit like having both feet in a bag of concrete, and you're trying to survive sometime. You know all that about the history of Plone. It's based on SOAP 2, which is 14 or 15 years old. CMF comes from the early 2000s. And lots of new code is written, and in many cases the old code is kept for whatever reason, basically for having backwards compatibility to old add-ons and so on. So we basically have an old stack, lots of new stuff, but in some cases it might be necessary to perform more radical cuts in order to get rid of old code. For example, we came across in one migration in Plone 4.3 there is this new approach for extending the member data schema with an extender. So basically define your additional member fields as a schema and then make some configuration with setCML. But you still have to perform a configuration in the old member data XML file, where you basically map the field name in the schema to some property in your portal member data something tool. And if there is a mismatch between the types, then you get also some fancy error messages, where just say, okay, where is this coming from? Next, so some reasons that don't directly related to programming, but I made some Plone developer survey some weeks ago, and it showed some interesting results. From my point of view, the whole Plone world, as with other CMS communities, are in a kind of either staying on the same level or stagnation mode. So one question was about the observation of the Plone community growth. So the upper chart, so basically 1 means shrinking, 5 means growing, and a big majority, almost, let's say, at least 56%, said that their impression is that the Plone community is shrinking and not growing. In comparison to that, I asked them about how do they consider Plone for further projects, and here we have the opposite. They say Plone is important and the amount of projects could possibly grow. So it's basically some imbalance between people doing Plone and perhaps expectations from customers with Plone projects. About demographics. As you can see, the majority of the community are, well, 31 is not old, but at least far beyond a senior developer. That's perhaps a lot of people that started with Plone 10 years ago, and now we are 10, 15 years older. And you see a huge gap, well, actually no guy under 20 and only 10% or 7% between 20 and 30. I cannot comment on the gender, but but we could do better, but that's not my problem.
I think that that graph about age is a bit biased because you did the survey over Twitter, and like people that follow you are normally about your age or younger.
Well, I posted it to the Plone list. Wasn't Plone list the link?
That's true. Sorry.
Yep. And it was on community plone org for all people that are just using web interfaces. So yes.
I have to disagree with you and say the second issue is actually everyone's problem.
Pardon?
The second gender issue is actually your problem and everyone else's. Just saying.
Because I just like
got
the same in the whole
party. That's not my topic. One strange observation was basically about the distribution of the answers. We had 103 answers from developers, and 75% of all answers came from Europe. Only 10% from North America, and then the rest Asia and so on. This was kind of surprising. I have no idea where this European dominance is coming from. Any idea?
Germans.
Germans rule the world. No, this was 6 years ago.
I think this is actually due to the fact that in the States, it's moving much more towards people are buying online services. They're far less concerned about putting their data up in the NSA cloud. whereas in Europe, there's a stronger feeling towards putting stuff, running stuff themselves in their own company, and so I think it's actually the whole move to software as a service
okay.
in the States is much further along than in Europe.
Okay. Yes.
To add to that, I'd say that their American software providers have a lot more marketing dollars, obviously, to nail open source projects in the States. And I don't think open source CMSs are doing as well, just because there isn't that idea that Europeans have, which is they don't trust commercial providers who are in large part American. So I think that could be a part of it too.
Okay. I need to rush a bit. I have some more slides. I've also seen some marketing analysis about CMS stuff, and from my opinion, the complete CMS market is kind of shrinking. But it's only a question. I'm not saying that it's really the case, but in this chart you can see that basically people that basically the CMS market in their opinion is basically staying the same, neither growing or shrinking in that majority. But on the lower chart, you see that most of you see that the importance of Plone seems to be declining and shrinking and so on. But I won't comment on that. I asked myself, over the last weeks there was on Twitter some discussion about what makes Plone for me, under the hashtag, what makes Plone for me, I think so. My opinion that basically Plone was always an enterprise CMS system, and it will be the same. The good parts for Plone are basically for me the fine-grained security model. We have an extraordinary great outstanding security record over the last 12 years with compared to PHP and all this crap. So I think the last hotfix was at least a year ago, so that's great and great work. We have flexible workflows for content management, and we also had a great database, ZDB, but I think it's time to move on a bit. So just my personal opinion, what I'm thinking about that. Perhaps in some years, we have been talking about Plone 2020, and I saw this mind map from Eric Steele about what could be in several years from now. I really want to get rid of pretty much old code, because lots of code is just old, it's unmaintained, it's graphed, it's over-engineered or under-designed or both. Stuff like portlets, sets reform. For example, I've been using Pyramid last year in a big project for anchors, and doing forms in Pyramid with a deform in Colander is just the way to do it. It just offers you both modules enough functionality to do it right, to customize stuff. And sets reform, for example, is completely over-engineered, and it's brainfuck. Sorry for violating the code of conduct. So this was basically from the technical point of view. As a consultant and integrator, I'm doing business with Plone. I want to get new customers with Plone, and I see basically Plone in a market where basically right now enterprise content management, the classical intranet, external solutions, and so on. And what I really want to see, stuff like a much better search engine, better integration with Elasticsearch or Solr.
What's wrong with Solr currently? The state of Solr in Plone, the integration, collective Solr or the CCDAP integration?
I tried it several times. Perhaps there was a mismatch between the Plone version and the supported version of the modules. I don't have much experience with Solr, but I've been working with Elasticsearch over the last two years, and there are actually two integrations with Elasticsearch. There's collective Solr index and collective Elasticsearch, and both are a bit fragile. So I basically, when I want to install Plone in 5 years, I just want to have the support of the box. Because the Z catalog was a nice thing, but the full text search, especially the text in G3, which I wrote 10 years ago, well, it was nice, but we have better options right now.
The Solr index plugin is a fully baked Z catalog plugin that's transactionally safe, so you should check that one out.
Yeah, okay. I was also about thinking about what would be the best option for database. As that CDB is fine for many purposes, but I think we should perhaps think about other options in this way. Python 3 support, of course, I think nobody wants to go in 5 years work with Python 2.7 or so, or Python 2.8, and we need a more better architecture. So this brings us basically to the discussion how to get there, how to get to Plone 2020, or however we call it. The first thing is we just need to define what Plone means for us. Where is Plone important? Where do we want to compete with other CMS systems or other applications? And find out the areas where we don't want to compete with stuff like WordPress. And then we just have to look at what will be in 5 years. It's hard to predict because the market is changing pretty fast, and we can make decisions today about stuff that will be happening in 5 years, because so that's kind of a problem. So we have to be very careful about the future scope of Plone and just define where we want to go. And especially given the limited number of resources and just either money and, of course, persons, that would be pretty limited, because right now I see that the development is pretty slow right now, just because we're a small community. And of course, we can replace the full Plone that we wrote over 10 years now, let's say in 2 or 3 years, with the same functionality. So basically, for Plone 2020, we really have to kick SOAP 2. Its development is dead since ages. The same with CMF. We can talk about ZA, how that would fit into a further framework. And perhaps some replacement for the ZDB. There are, of course, other options on the market, right? It's NoSQL databases except MongoDB. The point is basically that as Eric proposed in his Plone 2020 presentation or mind map, going to stuff like Pyramid as a platform, Python 3, perhaps we should think about some pluggable persistence API and persistence layer and see what's on the market on as databases, either traditional databases supporting stuff like JSON support, for example, as a replacement for pickles, just some weird thoughts. In general, we had now 12 years of Plone and SOAP. The time of the application server is over. This was basically last decade. And the world moves on to much smaller solutions, where you just take a small framework like Pyramid, plug in your Elasticsearch, take your database you need, either MongoDB or Cassandra, or there's stuff like OrientDB, FoundationDB, lots of interesting new databases with nice features, some limitations. You just basically, we have to look at what's going on the market. And I'm coming to the end. If you are going to rewrite Plone in several years and let's say having a new version in 2020, I would never ever call this Plone. You could develop this under the brand of Plone, but as history told us with SOAP 2 and SOAP 3, and then we had 5, so that's basically confusing. Basically, I give you a use a different name for that. It could be placed under the umbrella of Plone, but call it Bob or whatever. Exactly the same happened in the Tybo 3 world. Tybo 3 is also a pretty old CMS system, pretty popular in Germany or Europe. And they create a new version of Tybo 3 that was incompatible with the older version, which caused some confusion, and then they rewrote Tybo 3 from scratch and they called it Neos. And it's still labeled under the Tybo 3 Foundation, but it's still a complete new name to make a distinction between the old Tybo 3 and, let's say, the complete new CMS Neos.
Are you really saying that the complete rewrite in the ZOAP community from ZOAP 2 and ZOAP 3 was a good model, and from the Tybo 3 approach to create a complete new CMS is a good approach and that worked for either ZOAP 3 or Tybo 3?
I'm only talking about the names.
Because, I mean, those are both two examples where it did not work, and in the end,
I have no idea about this Tybo 3. I'm just saying that they just decided to give it a different name, just to make the distinction between the old Tybo 3 that exists since 10 years.
Successful.
Yeah, that's my point.
It was successful for pylons. Pylons. Pyramid is a new pylons.
Yeah. But it's not a rewrite. There was a migration part.
No,
there
wasn't. Pyramid was BFG. Yes, I know.
There was
a migration.
There was a
long
recommendation how to migrate your
Paris
applications to.
Okay, can we discuss this later? I just need to come to an end because we're running out of time. So as I said, we had a developer survey some weeks ago with about 100 answers. There's a link to the results. The most important information from the survey basically comes from the comments about pros and cons in Plone, and it's a pretty long list. It's hard to extract some common pattern information. Just read and get some idea about what people are finding good in Plone and what the problems are. So, any questions?
My question is, did you bring the stones for us?
That's your task.
Crap. My real question is, are you aware that most of the things that you said in your talk aren't that controversial amongst Plone core developers, the framework team, or whatever?
I have no idea about that because I don't belong to the core team. I'm having an eye on you,
yeah.
But I don't have a complete idea what basically consensus. I think you're going in the same direction, but I also got some feedback from, let's say, the core Plone fanboys that perhaps would throw some stones at me if they could.
I'm not aware of those kind of people because, like, I'm in the framework team and we're like discussing those kind of exactly what you tackle in your task. We're discussing about those things. We're aware of that. It's just hard to like for instance the getting rid of old stuff. Right? We have a couple of flips in for Plone 5 where we worked on that, but nobody really sees that because it's not fancy and it's really hard to find people to get to work on that, yeah. Because you don't get anything out of it, right?
It's boring stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So
there's no money in it. You can't do it on the customer like as part
exactly.
of the project
yeah.
in
yeah.
any way.
That's a problem. Alexander.
Well, I have questions on how you might can help. For my experience, one of the most frustrating thing about changing the way Plone development goes is that there is no knowledge about how to mark something as deprecated, and you have been at the SOAP core developers and sometimes, and they have a deprecation system for it.
Yeah.
So at least make some documentation.
In SOAP 3 or CEA, we had stuff like
yeah.
that, but I was completely outside the scope of the CEA. So I only know SOAP 2. SOAP 3 was always evil.
Hi, Andres. First, I just want to second what Timo said, although Timo is gone. You'd actually find very little disagreement among people who are following things. So if you just took off the title of the talk, everybody would have, you know, there'd be no stones at the end. Everybody would be just be saying, yeah, we've been working on those things for 2 years. The other thing I wanted to say, just in case there are people listening who don't know, you really weren't talking about migrations from Plone 4 to Plone 4.3. When you put in Plone app events, which is in alpha, Plone app content types, current version also in alpha, and then put that together with other components, you're actually migrating from 4.0 to something vaguely between 4.3 and 4.5 that everybody considers in flux and thought that alpha was an adequate warning that they might not work well together.
Yeah, that's right, but I think this Plone, especially Plone app event, always had a branch for 4.3 and 5, and they always, we were under the impression that it would be supported for all versions, and even if it was in alpha state, basically we had a one-year project time, so basically why would we stop, why would we use the old archetypes content type or write our own event if we would expect that in 1 year most of problems would be resolved.
Well,
but
the point is you were migrating to the cutting edge, not to the stable product.
I'm aware of that, but for example, the documented version dependencies didn't work, and it's very hard to figure out the dependencies that have been working. But for the developer in the company, it's just that they couldn't measure that on their own. So that's basically the problem. So I have perhaps the knowledge, I know you guys, I know who was writing this module, but a person not that doesn't belong to the community and doesn't know the person has no chance for finding out what belongs together and how to get help here. That's the point.
There are plenty of opportunities to find out what goes together and how things work by coming into IRC, by sending notes to the message board. There's a lot of friendly people in this room who are happy to answer questions.
I'm fully aware of that, but as I said, the problem basically the developers that don't belong to the core community, and there are a lot of developers that don't get in touch with you core developers or the official Plone community. That's a problem. for these people, and that raises a lot of frustration on this developer level.
Yeah, I mean that's why we want to have an open and welcoming and friendly place for them to come and ask us questions and be able to approach us in a way that doesn't get shut down.
Are we losing the focus of this talk, by the way?
So it's think this through.
I'll talk to you in IRC anytime you like. I'll talk to you anytime you want in IRC.
No.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
No.
One more question.
Question and pointing out something. I think two things to do with the end of your talk, which I happen to agree with as well. I think the framework team and maybe where we're going with that has not been communicated at all effectively. Because if that's the way you're all going, maybe you need to let the wider community or communicate that better. I think we forget that Plone's not just a system, it's a set of ideals about how we deal with content, how we make things available for NGOs, ease of use, security models. We shouldn't be tied to one technology because we'll just be buried and we'll disappear. So we do need to move on, but there's an old saying about swords. If you have a sword from the 13th century, as it goes through the centuries, bits replaced, the handle, blade's a bit different with new technology, the guards get replaced, but it's the same sword, and it's still your granddad's sword. It's just more up to date. That was all.
Two things. Just quick about the Plone content types, widgets, events thing. I think it would be reckless to recommend a customer to work with Plone widgets because, like at least a year ago, because it was a moving target. Everybody knew that. Plone content types without Plone widgets is pretty solid, I think.
Plone content types is solid.
Kind of solid. It's like
yeah. it's fucking solid.
We're getting there. But there is no clear path of where we're going into the future. I started, I didn't start, but I voiced the 2020 roadmap discussion at the conference in Brazil, and there is still there's no agreement on where we're actually going. We're going to have agreement here. And this is why the Plone framework team and the community and community leaders have not said, we're going to do this and this and this, because we will have to decide what we do. You raised some very controversial points about thinking a rewrite and a rename, rebrand would be something. A lot of people might disagree. This might be a hard decision we'll have to make as a community. But this discussion is happening, and we have not been voicing these very different opinions publicly very loud, because there's also a marketing punishment from voicing these opinions too loud. But at this conference, I think a talk like this is actually really helpful, because at this conference, I hope at least so, we're going to have a discussion that will lead to decisions that lead to a roadmap that we think we can follow and we can voice and make that publicly available. Having that like a year ago would have been really reckless, because nobody would have known, we're unsure where to go and this is our marketing strategy, not a good marketing strategy. But thanks for your talk.
Thank you.
Just to say thanks.
Oh, thank you.